Let the streaming begin. And it is begun. So everybody, whatever you say, it's going to be broadcast to the entire world. So
we're live now, right?
Yeah. So I will take a look here. What I was going to say, you're telling me you're starting to do a show, which you're welcome to promote as much as you want.
Well, I appreciate it.
Yep. And you have OBS. I use Wirecast, and this is the studio.
Nice.
Bum, bum, ba.
Yeah, I'm, like I said, I've got my plans all laid out. I'm just a matter of getting it all put back together when my basement gets done. That's nice. Beautiful.
All right. David, do you have a, wait a minute, there's, what have I done? Oh,
what'd you do? We're up.
I got the wrong thing here.
I'm up. I'm loading the YouTube so I can watch and got the chat.
There we go.
I have the studio here. You can see.
Yeah, you've got a shot that can show the studio.
No,
that's it right there.
But you have.
I could maybe if this camera will come off. Let's see here. I can.
You'll rebuild the studio.
I'm in progress. So let's see. Let me switch to the other camera. You see it now? Yeah. So This is, I've got four up here. This is the other show I just got off. I'm watching to make sure they don't screw things up too bad. This is this side. I've got the monitor and the audio and all the, yeah.
Nice. Well done as well.
This is my messy garage, and it's a constant work in progress, but we'll get there.
Okay, so what is the other show that you do? Ham Radio Guy?
The Ham Radio Guy, exactly. So
and what do you do on that show?
So right now, primarily, it's just been doing audio podcasts talking about, I'll have some type of little topic in there. I've talked about MCOM. I did a 3-part series on that last fall. And to be honest, that's probably been one of my most popular podcasts that's been downloaded. And I've done things talking about Parks on the Air. We've done stuff at like Huntsville or Hamcation, where I've done interviews with various vendors and talking about their products and whatnot. And then we've had, we'll talk about the news. We'll do kind of a list of, hey, here's some upcoming Hamfest in the area. And, I've done some interviews with Bob Heil, in fact. I've got one with.
Did you ask him if he likes me or not?
Don't ask him. You don't want to know.
It's already done. It's over and done.
And then I've got one coming up with, Megan Brooks with American Filament out of Huntsville, Alabama, coming up this week. And so I'll be releasing that here soon as well. So,
okay. So in other words, a general ham radio show.
Just a general ham radio show. And I'm just a single host right now. So kind of looking for another host, but it's always more fun when you have interaction, but those sort of things just build with time.
That's exactly what I did when I found David. I've been doing solo show for years and said, I need someone to bounce things off of. Keep me sane.
Yeah, I joined Gary in the 200s. And we're into about the 500 now.
Yeah. I'd like to produce them more weekly, but it's right now it's just bi-weekly.
Mm-hmm.
I also do anchoring for This Week in Amateur Radio podcast. So for all the news, so I do an anchor for them as well. So I try and split them every other week if I can.
There are too many shows out there.
Oh, there is. Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that. Yeah. Gary basically at the end of a show put out a request for help. And I
help!
Yeah, and I answered the call, and look where I am here.
And just stuck there with you are now.
Yeah, actually, and it was totally MCOM oriented at the time.
Yeah,
and David say
my interest or specialty.
Yeah, but then we generalized him, and we're trying to extralize him, but he's resistant.
Well, it's good to have a variety. You can find somebody who can listen to all kinds of different stuff, and you always have new interests and things to talk about, and it's kind of nice for your listeners as well to give them variety. I've told jokes on there as well. I've done all kinds of little stuff.
Jokes? You're trying to be funny? There's no humor in ham radio. You can't be funny in ham radio.
All right. There's no laughter here.
No.
It's all seriousness.
Yeah.
No, not this show.
One big joke, right? No, I'm kidding. Here I am, a guest. No.
You're not kidding, and it is very true.
Well, that's one of our things is we will get funny and we'll also get serious and get into the controversial
things. Jerry says our audio is way out of sync.
Me. Who's low, Jerry?
Hello?
He didn't say out of audio levels. Not, he said out of sync.
Oh, yeah. Like, YouTube will do that sometimes.
Yeah. It seems to be doing that a lot lately.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. It says big time. So there's we're sending things in sync, best I can tell. Not much we can do about that.
You have to check that that speed rate thing.
I guess
you may have had an update and may change it. It's probably too late to fix it for today.
Well, let's go see.
Okay.
And I'm not sure what you mean by speed rate.
There was I don't remember what there was a data
rate. Oh, data rate. Yeah, I'm sending about 2,500 bits per second, I believe, which should be fine, but I will just double check and make sure I didn't screw that up.
Pop out the chat. Chat down here.
Yeah, when you start doing television, Martin, when you start doing the TV stuff, it's going to get much more complicated than doing the audio.
Yeah, I was playing with a little bit of that this afternoon, trying to figure a better way to do it, because I did my last one. It wasn't so bad, but it's like I'm trying to find ways to improve it. It gets better every time I do it, so it's a practice.
I'm getting an error, though. YouTube is not receiving enough video to maintain smooth streaming. As such, viewers will experience ... It's not going to tell me what they're experiencing. So I don't know why that would be.
It's a little choppy. The picture on YouTube is clear, but it is a little choppy. I just see I'm moving around. I just blew my nose, and I apologize for doing that on the air. And I can see when I'm moving around, it is a little choppy. That's all feed out of your house, Gary.
Yeah.
And I don't know if we can do anything about it.
Let me see. What kind of bitrate I'm sending it to the world here.
You're still recording local?
Yeah.
So worst case scenario, after we're done recording, you can post that.
Yeah, I hate to do that because it makes the live one go away off of YouTube.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, in theory, we should be sending 2.5 megabits, and what I'm showing here is that these green lines are the instantaneous measurement of the output, the data rate, and it's 1 megabit or a little bit below. So that is a little bit low, but I don't know why, because I'm on a 600 megabit symmetrical fiber connection. And now Kent says no audio.
I can hear me.
On YouTube?
Well, here, let me check. And here's how I love to do this.
There's audio.
Yeah, there's audio.
Yeah, there's audio.
And so the next question becomes, how about Facebook? Because we're going there too.
You know what I think about that?
That we shouldn't.
Yep.
Got 59 seconds to debug the Facebook.
No, I can check. I don't know why I'm so opposed to that.
Because it's evil. Facebook is evil.
There's audio on Facebook.
All right.
I just call it fake book, you know.
Okay, so let's check a little synchronization on Facebook and see what it seems to be doing.
Well, the problem is when you load the Facebook, my feed always goes right into the start the show, not where we are.
Not live.
There you go. You're about 9 seconds off.
9 seconds out of sync.
Well, that was when you had both of those up a minute ago. What I can see in the YouTube is when you had both the Facebook up and the countdown timer was about 9 seconds off.
Now, let's not confuse being out of sync with latency.
That's okay.
Because
I'm good at confusing those things.
Yeah, because latency is a totally different animal. I'm going to make the Facebook go away. We'll just have to suffer with it.
It's that time.
Yeah, because the timer has expired. And so, let's see. David, this is really your show. Do you want to do the intro thing? Do you know? No, do you even know how?
You're driving. I'll let you drive. Because I don't know. I don't remember exactly what show number and the...
Yeah. Well, all that stuff would come up for you and show it off the screen.
It's this been a week.
Is Ham Radio Now the most important amateur radio program on the internet? Where did it go? Oh, there we go. And the show is episode 512, January 14th, 2024, Field Day of Frost. Think Field of Frost, like Field of Dreams. Well, I'm hearkening back to an ancient show we did many years ago on Field Day called Field of Beams, the summer Field Day. This is Field of Frost.
This is the funny part.
A little alliteration, a little humor, a little snowman, a little Mother Frost nature, and then your logo. Everything is great. Let's see. Moving across the screen on screen right, it is.
I am live from the garage below my parents' house along Mulholland Drive in the base of the Santa Monica Mountains in beautiful, sunny Southern California, although it is 60 degrees here in the shack. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Marvin, did you hear the way he did that?
I did.
Okay, so I'm going to do it, and then you have 12 seconds to figure out how to do it for yourself. From the studio in the bonus room above the garage on the north side of Fort Mill, South Carolina, in the shadow of Charlotte, in the foot of Mount Belzoni, I'm Gary Pierce, K4AQ. I am a high-riz king of ham. And then
Gary does it better than I do, by the way.
I'm a pro.
Well, we do some introductions for This Week in Amateur Radio, and coming to you from the state of Massachusetts, where it doesn't decide where it can't decide whether it wants to be warm or cold, and it changes by daily. Wait 5 minutes, and the weather will change here. I'm Marvin Turner, W0MET, the president of Winter Field Day.
The Winter Field Day Association.
True, Winter Field Day Association. Yeah. That's correct. That's true.
Because you would be actually the king of Winter Field Day. if we were going to do it that way. And so that's what the show is all about. Winter Field Day.
Where in Massachusetts are you?
So I'm in the western half of Massachusetts, and we like to call that the better side of Massachusetts, or some will call it Taxachusetts here. But I'm over here just to the west northwest of Springfield, in a little town called Southampton. Which I found to be, they call them towns around here. They don't call them cities or whatever. They're called towns, and that's what they want to be called, as a town. So a little change from, grew up in Missouri, moved to Minnesota. So I'm used to the Northland and being cold. That's not a problem. And then I moved to Tennessee, really got to enjoy the winters there, where there was basically no snow, but they are apparently getting some, about 7 inches today, talking with friends just a little bit ago. And then, now I live back up here in Massachusetts in the Northland. Relocated here because of my wife and her job. And so Winter Field Day will take on a whole new meaning for me this year. me and my second year running the organization, now actually in the bold north in the winter area. So
I have been aware of Winter Field Day for a while. What year did you actually get it started?
So... Winter Field Day really started in about like 2000.
This is not an invitation to launch into a dialogue.
No, it's not.
What year did you start?
So, I started in 2022 with it in about June of 2022. And Winter Field Day was last year for 2023 in January, is my first Winter Field Day that we ran as an organization, as we took it over. So Winter Field Day started about 2007, got turned over to a group in 2015. And I took it again over in 2022. So
okay,
I'm so now the third hand of this.
Yeah. Okay. So it's moved from one hand to another. So it's been around for a while. And I've been aware of it for a while. I don't think I've ever actually participated, but every time I talked about it, it would be, I grew up and my ham career started in the 60s in Chicago, where Field Day in the summer was relatively pleasant. And then in 1990, I moved to North Carolina. and similar to Tennessee, maybe even a little bit hotter and more humid, saying, WTF, who thought of field day in late June when it's guaranteed to be 95 degrees, 95% humidity, and thunderstorms all weekend long?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I experienced that a lot in Tennessee.
Yeah, clearly field day was invented by somebody who lived in Connecticut.
Yeah, in Los Angeles, yeah. we get 90, 95 to 101. And yes, it's not humid, but it's hot.
Yeah. So I'm always making fun of field day like that and thinking, you know, winter field day would be a great idea. But yet I have not ever.
Well, it's funny. We talk about a summer field day and we talk about winter field day. We've really got the worst of two conditions. You got it really damn cold or you got it really, really hot, you know? And so we've had some people email us and go, well, can you do a spring and summer too? So spring and fall. Those are better conditions, better times to be able to do that. How about you run those instead? And let's change the dates on these things. And it's like, I don't know if I really want to take on a spring and a fall too, but it's a lot to just run one time a year.
So you weren't the guy who decided when winter field day was going to be. The date hasn't changed, right?
Nope, date has not changed. It's been that way since it started in 2007 when the organization first took over.
Yeah,
and so it was initially the Society for the Preservation of Amateur Radio that came out of Pennsylvania, and then it actually didn't become a Winter Field Day Association until 2015 when the other group took it over.
It looks to me like it was set at the polar opposite of the calendar. The best it could possibly be, that the polar opposite would be December, but that's Christmas and New Year. If you went the other way, it would be November. That would be Thanksgiving. So January is what it's going to be. And that's pretty much the opposite of the summer field day. That will be the deciding date. Yes, a spring or fall would be great. All activities are in the spring or fall.
Right. It's kind of funny because, like, you know, a lot of the weather, if you look at it across the nation, the winter weather really hasn't set in until, you know, call it the last maybe 2 weeks for a lot of the country, where it's starting to get really cold and have a lot of snow. And so, it seems like today, November, December are usually more mild for weather. So nothing like January being the date of really having a true winter date put out there. When it really is cold and testing your ability during the because by the time February comes around, it can start to get warm in some parts of the country, and then March is getting much better. So yeah, January, yeah, we got to put it at the best of winter, you know?
Yep. Well, I think one of the points, and maybe a point you've adopted, you inherited, is it's not really the idea of just having a pleasant weather field day. The idea seems to be, You're reading over your website, it's a disaster preparedness MCOM oriented. It's not a contest. It's not like summer field day, which is just everybody gets together and has fun and get out in the field. And yeah, okay, we've got the label of preparedness on it, but you know, nobody takes that too seriously. But you guys are saying disasters don't pick nice weather. They could come anytime. You got to be prepared for no matter what. So.
They really do. And I want to read this kind of verbatim. You know, we call Winter Field Day, and I want to make sure I get this right. So Winter Field Day is a communications exercise formatted to help increase your level of preparedness for disasters and improve your operational skills in subpar conditions. And we always kind of go off that subpar conditions, because that could be freezing, rain, snow, hail, sleet, you know, flooding, tornadoes. You don't know what your condition is going to be. So we kind of leave that. It's more broad, but it's one of those things that, you know, you're not going to be called out in the greatest of, you know, summer degree and sunny weather to be able to do something if you really had to operate. Or if you're even, you know, your own personal situation, if, you know, you're trying to get a hold of family and your phones are down, cell phones are down, and you're going to try and get a hold of a ham radio operator, you may not have the greatest of conditions yourself at your own house because of a tornado that went through. You might be working from, a radio of some sort that you had in your vehicle. Can you make the wind link connection with that? Can you send a message to family with that? Can you, Just get a hold of another operator, maybe in that area, but part of the country where your family is, and let them know that you're okay. So, you know, it's really about preparing for, you know, disasters and how you can prepare yourself for those times to, you know, be efficient in your radio operating skills and have your equipment up and running. Because what good is it if you are like, well, shoot, I should have thought about that, or I should have had that available to myself. and you don't, you know. So do you have that go bag and that kit ready to deploy for Winlink setup or whatever else you need to do?
So I guess we ought to step back and get the general stuff down there. Let people know what this is all about. Winter Field Day. Let me show your website while I'm talking about this. Absolutely. Is January 27th, 28th. So not this weekend, but the next weekend coming up as we do this program live. For those of you that are watching on Memorex, you'll just have to go look at your calendar. It's January 27th and 28th. What else is there about Winter Field Day that people ought to know? What makes it different from Summer Field Day? What do they have to do?
So we have some similar rules to Summer Field Day. We're going to still let you operate on HF, VHF, UHF. We allow operation worldwide. So even stations over in, you know, Europe or, you know, Middle East or whatever, they can operate as Winter Field Day as well.
Okay, so that's a big difference.
That is one of the big differences for sure. And again, you're pretty much used to free to use any mode you want. Let me rephrase that. You can use any mode you want that can faithfully transmit the message exchange intact. So I will tell people right now, FT4 and FT8 are out. One of the deals that was not allowed when the prior group came in, and it's not allowed with us too. It's kind of a promise I made to them that I would not allow FT4, FT8 to come into Winter Field Day. And we want people to use PSK31, RTTY, JS8 call. I mean, there's lots of others out there, FL Digi, that you can use besides just FT4 and FT8. You know, we stay away from the work bands, WARC bands. And, you know, we really encourage people to, you know, get together as a club, as friends, family, however you want, and just try and set up, you know, something in a remote location or get outdoors somehow and, you know, really set things up. And we've gotten rid of the, again, you started to mention a minute ago, we try and get rid of the contest portion of this and make it more of an exercise.
Do you keep score?
So there's still
a score. Do you announce winners and losers or top and bottom?
We will announce what your individual score is. So if you made 100 contacts, we'll take the multipliers and all those other items that, you know, if you had CW, you get more points versus a voice contact. So we'll add all those up and we'll give you a score. And that's really to, you know, kind of see how you do overall. So we keep a contest portion to this, but our goal is really to make this more objective based, where you can say, all right, you're going to be out there and work for 6 hours. You can, you know, set up a wing link contact. Can you set up an antenna? Can you operate off of, you know, something other than shore power, commercial power? Do you have generator batteries? How do your batteries hold up? You know, in Texas during the winter, a battery holds up for probably 8 hours just fine, versus that same battery may not hold up in the winter in Minnesota quite as well in that cold weather. We just know batteries don't par as well or fare as well in winter as they do in summer, you know. So so those are some of our objectives. I want to say, if you pull up our website, I know they're on there under the rules this year. There should be, I think, 10 of them. And I don't remember what the other ones go up under. You see rules somewhere. Yep, rules. And then scroll down just a little bit. Our operating guideline. Oh, yep. You were just about there.
Yeah, I needed to make this a little bigger for the TV audience.
Yep. There you go. Clicking here. Yep. And I want to see what those are.
Okay. So it's a PDF people can download.
Yeah, it's a PDF people can come download, look at it real easy. And just a couple pages down here, we'll talk about which of those are kind of our table of contents, and shouldn't be too much farther down the page from that. So there's objectives, categories. Come back and talk about those in a minute. And
I guess the exchange, that's going to be an interesting thing for everybody.
The only thing we did last year, we added MX and DX. So MX is for Mexico and US is for all other DX stations. So we've changed that from what it was initially, but we still use all the US Canadian rack sections as designated by those organizations. So we keep those pretty much the same. We've limited QRP, I believe is 10 watts. And so that's in there as well.
ARRL field day, I think, is 5 watts.
Is it 5 watts? Yeah, we're allowing 10. So it might be. I couldn't tell you right off the top of my head.
Okay, 1 point for phone, CW and digital, 2 points.
Become 2 points, yep.
Yep. Multipliers or power output. Band mode multipliers. I'll have to look at that carefully here.
So yeah, it's kind of an interesting formula we've come up with for that. I mean, it's pretty common.
Okay, so that's something different than they're doing in Summerfield, eh? And by the way,
you
are not ARRL affiliated at all, right? This is not a
legal. We are not. So we are a complete independent 501c3 organization. You can donate to us. It is a tax write-off for you. So we are completely self-funded. We have to pay for, we're able to save a little bit of money now. We just found out that Google Workspace is free for nonprofits. But we still have a website. We still have hosting. We still have a website editor we pay to be able to keep up with some of those things. So, we do appreciate any donations. We can be made right there on our website as well. So, yeah. But to answer your question, we do have quite a few changes from ARRL overall.
Okay. So people need to go through this and if they're going to operate it, they'll need to make sure that they're not relying
where on you are is those additional objectives are like really
key. Yep, there we go. Yeah.
That is like, to me, this is the value of what this program, and we'll talk a little bit about how many people participate. It would be great if there were more, but these objectives of, you know, alternate power away from home, we want to talk through how you guys came up with this and what the reasons behind that were.
Yep. So we took a little bit of what we had for stats last year, and I can share some of that stuff with you as well in a few minutes here. But we, again, wanted to make this more objective-based, so we have kind of come up with a bunch of brainstorming and figured out that we want to use these objectives instead of bonuses. And it's kind of like, yeah, if you ever work 13 colonies or you work Route 66, you go to achieve, or even battleships on the air weekend, you have a list of 13 states you're trying to get a hold of for 13 colonies. We'll use that as an example. And you want to go try to get that certificate to get a QSL card from each location. And when you get that certificate, it shows that you achieved your goal of achieving all 13 colonies, right? So we've kind of gone along the same lines because all those events I just listed are very, very popular. I mean, they are just loaded with QSO contacts across the country. I mean, the operators of those stations they could barely keep up with everybody trying to contact them to get their 13 colonies. People just come out for that event in hordes. And so anyway, we're kind of hoping that Winterfield, they can take on the same type of greatness where you have these objectives that people want to go out and try and achieve this objective to get that certificate in the end. And so we came up and started brainstorming all these different ideas. And so operating on, 100% power, making a satellite contact, operating for 6 hours minimum, setting up an outside antenna. And so, I mean, there's just a few, again, I'm naming here, but you'll kind of receive when you go to submit your log, you'll check a box by each of those, and then you'll have a certificate. We've got like little icons on your certificate this year. I'm kind of giving a little bit away. But we'll have some icons on your certificate showing that you achieved, 8 out of 10 or 10 out of 10. You've got 100% or you've got an 80% score of achieving all those objectives for the Winter Field Day event. And so, we found that a lot of people average work time for people from home is about 4.4 hours. We find outdoors people work a little bit longer typically. If we can have more objectives to drive people outdoors to be able to spend more time doing,
Yeah, I guess if they've gone to the trouble to setting up a station out there, they're going to use it for a while.
They want to use it for a while. Yeah. And so trying to get more people outdoors, more people to use it. But I mean, I do understand the exceptions of, hey, you know what? I'm 65 years old. I'm 80 years old. And I just can't get out and set up and work winter field day. I want to be able to work the stations. I want to be able to do it. But I just don't have the ability. My body's not capable. It's just too cold for me. You know, I understand all those things happen. So we're going to keep that home category in there. That's not going to exchange to allow those people to be able to work winter field day event. We want them to participate. But really, the goal is to get people outside to be able to achieve these objectives, because we want you to try those subpar conditions again, bringing it full circle there and having to set those things up. I can set up a wing like station at my house just fine. That works no problem. But can I do it from out over here, you know, 3 miles down the road in a park? Does it work the same? So can I get it to work? What type of troubles or, you know, issues do I run into? What's not working here for me?
I like the goal, you know, working six different bands as part of the activities, you know, and sending that wind link. You know, the other podcast that I do is really around wind link training and development. And that's a really key, you know, emergency communications tool. That whole suite, you know, WinLink is like an EOC in a box. Once you get into all of the forms and the templates and all the things you can do with it, is huge. And I could see why. I know we participated in it a couple of years ago, and there were a lot of questions when we started doing it, the winter field day out here. There were people saying, well, why can't we do FTA? There's a lot of points to be there. And I, you know, had to have that conversation around, you know, this is an emergency communications exercise. And everybody would say, well, regular field day is too, and they let us use it. And, you know, the reality of being able to help people understand, I cannot send a message other than a short exchange about what's going on, where I am, what the problem is, using FTA, that you could use, you know, you can send via WinLink, you can send RTTY, you can send in these other, you know, PSK31 once you make those connections. That it makes sense to me to say, hey, we just don't want that type of traffic in this event. It's just a way to, like, you know, knock up your logs, but not really in an emergency communication style.
You're exactly right. I mean, you hit that right on the head. I couldn't have said it better myself. But the thing is what we find, I've done some FT4 and I've done some FT8, and it's great. I mean, it's fine. You can make up a lot of contacts. You can, you know, hit a lot of stations in a short period of time. And that's wonderful. It's great. But again, it's not really about, you know, how many points you can make or how many contacts you're going to get and how many stations out there you can, you know, pick up in over an hour's time. I think FT4 and FT8 personally are like shooting fish in a barrel. I mean, it's pretty easy to do for the most part once you get your setup up and running. But the you're exactly right. It doesn't pass the test for emergency communication and sending messages. And then that's why we don't do it. And that's the biggest part we have to try and overcome in letting people know about FT4 and FT8 and why it doesn't work for us. And we're not trying to be mean about it. We're not trying to be jerks here. It's just, it doesn't pass the test.
Do you get a lot of complaints?
We do. Well, I mean, I could show you probably pages and pages of emails that people send us on this. And I mean, I've had people, I'm disabled, I can't do this, I need FT4 and FT8. I said, there's lots of other digital modes that you can do. You can do PSK31. You can do, you know, FL Digi. You can do, you know, JSA call. You don't have to be limited to FT4 and FT8.
Nobody wants to be given alternatives. They want you to agree that the mode they want to
do
use,
it the easy way that they do it.
And,
yeah.
You know, exactly. They want to do it the easy way. And I'm not going to allow that to happen. It's amazing that
king of Winterfield Day,
King of Winterfield Day, and I may just be labeled that name. But here's the deal: what really irks me that I found out last year is that when we ask people to go submit a Cabrillo log file, okay, now I know what a Cabrillo log file is. I'm assuming both of you guys know what a Cabrillo log file is. You've been around probably long enough to know that. But it was amazing to me how many people would email us going, "How do I submit my log? What's a Cabrillo log format? What's ADIF?" And it's like, okay, I have an ADIF file because that's what Hammers uses, but how do I get that over to Cabrillo? So we literally create a system on our website that will take your ADIF file and convert it to Cabrillo for us. So it just blew my mind. It's like, you can do FT4 and FT8 all day long, but you don't know how to submit a log file.
Right. Or like, do a Google search. Do a Google search to say, how do I do this? Right.
Oh, God.
Right.
It's that easy.
The Facebook and Reddit are full of people that don't know how to use Google. I'm going to ask my question and ask humans to answer when the information is readily available out there. But then the Google response, Google is your friend. I don't like that either. So I don't
know. Yeah, we have we do get a lot of positive emails too. Hey, thank you guys for doing Winter Field Day. We really appreciate what you do. Thank you for hosting this. Thank you for doing everything you do. We really have this. We have a ton of fun. We've had clubs that, you know, that literally formed because of Winter Field Day. They've got groups together and, you know, they've told us, hey, this is how our club formed because we all enjoyed doing Winter Field Day together. So it's great to hear those type of stories. We really love people to submit photos to our Discord channel. So if you're not on Discord, you can go out and join us right there on our website. You can find it at the top of the page and our social media there. So love to have you join that. And we have a group of beta testers on there that we need to test software for. We're doing everything in house now. We're not using contest.com anymore for our log file program. So, we're doing everything in house and doing a cross checking, everything across, you know, like that. So, it's good. So
are you finding that more people want to participate from, the southern tier of the United States where the weather is going to be nicer, or do you have folks up north that are playing too?
You know, I'd have to go back and see if I can pull those numbers for what we have for each state. What I can tell you is like last year, Ohio was the most active with 104 stations on the air. And that, I would consider that more of a northern state. So that was good to see and hear. Before that, it was the year, it was 110 stations from North Carolina in the year before. So I don't really know whether it's more northern or more southern. I think we have a pretty good spread across the country.
Did you get anybody from Vermont?
Well, actually, if you go pull up our website, I can kind of tell you we can look at stations currently registered, and you can pull up the map. And this is the cool part that you can go see. So we do ask people to go out and register your station. Yeah, just the homepage there, right there on the homepage. Yep, scroll down.
472 registered.
Yeah, 472 registered. A little more there.
Okay.
Click on the map. Yep. So you're going to start to see where people are at now. So scroll, zoom in on that map a little bit.
Here, you want me to share my screen, Gary? I got it pulled up.
I'm
scrolling a little more.
I'm showing it
more.
Now,
yeah. Keep scrolling a little bit more. You'll see more detail. So you really see that we have a pretty good variety of people all over the country. And we've got the software in there this year now, where if you zoom in like that, you can start to see numbers by, you know, larger groups, and then you zoom in, you see there's 12 more right there. And let's say in the Chicagoland or let's say Indianapolis, you know, so either one,
it's
you can see there's 12 in the area.
It's jumping on me. So let me take a look up north here. Two in North Dakota, two in Montana, but, we get down to, well, there's New Mexico and Arizona, there. Three, Texas,
five,
Texas, you got all over the place. Okay.
Dallas is 23.
So. Yeah. Okay, so I'm seeing a little bit of
a little bit more south,
a little bit more to the south, and the folks that are really get the frigid stuff. Okay,
yeah, I don't know if even my group out in Massachusetts, they have not. So there's a group out in Massachusetts in the middle of Massachusetts that is supposed to be registered, and I haven't got them online. So I'll email him this week and say, hey, why aren't you on my map? Why aren't you registered as a website?
What is the snowflake icon that I'm seeing here?
So we've got the difference of whether I think the purple is private and the blue is public. And so we just make it, instead of just having a red dot like you would there for Google Maps, we try and put a snowflake in it. So
it looks like the blue ones are like clubs. Oh no, I see. This one's got a blue, a purple club. So I guess it is a private location. So
yeah, I think I think purple's private and blue is public. So
let's see how far up into Canada.
You can just find them and show up if they're advertising.
Yep, you can go find them and show up. Now, I mean, again, they are doing a private one. I mean, I guess you could show up there. They may not appreciate it, but if you zoom out, you actually see where we got people all the way across the country too, and around the world. I think we'll see. We go back a little bit more. There's
Yeah, I was looking up in Canada to see how far up into the super winter it gets. Anybody in Alaska?
Nope. I don't think nobody in Alaska. Not registered, at least right now.
Yeah.
But if you go back and look, there's people over in like United Kingdom, and there's like in the middle, maybe not quite Middle East, but Where's that number two at there? Bulgaria, and I don't remember what the other one just north of that was, but I saw those just the other day. Now, we will sometimes, you'll look on the map and see there's somebody from China in there. It's like, oh man, we got an interesting China station. If you go look at it, though, they're from the U.S., and what they did, they forgot to put the minus, maybe 92 or 86 or something in there. I don't see any in there right now. My brother and I went through those and fixed those last night. But people forget to put the negative in front of the longitude on our side of the country, and so they'll have a station like, hey, it's not showing up on my map. I'm registered. It's like, because you forgot to put the negative in front of it. You're over in China right now, but we'll fix it and take care of it, usually for them.
Okay, I was looking in the southern hemisphere where it's actually...
Not much there.
Where it's summer, we're not getting those folks yet.
So, nope.
Come on, you guys.
Somebody off of South America.
We got a big audience in South America and Australia. So.
Oh, really?
No, we don't. We don't have a big audience anywhere.
That's funny because I told you in the beginning you said promote a little bit, but I'm also the host of the Ham Radio Guy podcast, and I've actually got listeners all over the world. I've had some in Australia. I've had some in Europe. I've got some up in United Kingdom and Sweden area. And then, of course, you have in the U.S. and Canada. So, it's kind of interesting that I do have a wide variety of listeners around the world, which is kind of surprising. So,
yeah, we got the onesie twosies around the world too, but it's not like hundreds in Australia that are.
Oh yeah, no, not hundreds for sure. But it's kind of cool to see people registering for Winter Field Day around the world, though. Yeah. That is very cool to see.
Yeah, and that one off the coast of South America is. The Richfield Amateur Radio Club. They're one of those ones that has the GPS location that's wrong.
Okay, that's what that one is.
We'll run it down in our Winlink training quite a bit. The Richfield, Minnesota. They're just
that's one. That's,
I don't think they're renting a boat for this.
No, probably not that one.
Click on that one.
Out in the South Pacific.
That's funny. That one.
We're shaming the Richfield Radio Club, guys. Sorry, guys.
We're just trying to help them correct their submission.
Visitors, welcome. Bring your own boat.
I used to live in Minnesota. I'm very familiar with them. They're actually a great club, very active. But we'll go in and fix that for them. We'll get their negative set up. Usually when people go register, we have to approve all the registrations that come through. And so we have a lot on the back end we can go in and see and do. So it's pretty cool. So the other thing is, if one of you guys want to take it up while I start pulling up, is our newsletter. We have a newsletter out there. And we just put that out here in the last probably 2 weeks, a little behind this year, kind of in the middle of the fact that I had to move from Tennessee to Massachusetts. So a little behind on that one, but we just got it out. It got released. And you scroll over to the right, it should be in there just a little bit more. Winter Field Day 2024. Yep. So we've got the frozen feed line. So it's a nice newsletter. Got a little bit of tips in there.
But I was looking at that. I was realizing you guys do make a big play off of winter weather.
Oh, yeah, we do. Yeah, we try. So we've got like a chili in there, a white chicken chili in there this year. Actually, I made that about 2 weeks ago. It's phenomenal. Picture of my message from me. We've got highlighting one of our board members this year. And all kinds of links in there. You can go check things out. And we were just on Ham Nation here recently ourselves. So they invited us over here about 2 weeks ago to do that.
You know how to do the PR.
We do. We've been trying really hard to push that out. We've got Club Gear Online and JSE, who are both very great. They make some great swag for it.
There's the chicken chili recipe.
It's delicious. I literally made it 2 weeks ago. It was great. So turned out well. So my club I used that had in Tennessee, we actually did a chili cook-off every year. So, set up the tents. And, people really kind of go to some serious extremes on some of this Winter Field Day stuff. And then others are, perfect in sunny California, or they'll use an EOC or a church and, set up some outside antennas and, have a great time at it too. So it's a wide variety of what people can do and what people do for setups. And, again, we'd love for you to share those photos in our Discord channel. We'd love to see that. Sometimes we'll use them for our own media, sometimes down the road, but we will email you and say, hey, you've got a photo I hear on Facebook or on our Discord channel. Can we use it in some of our stuff? And it's, that's how some of the photos off our website came to fruition. So
do you do some like tips and tricks for how to actually make all this stuff work outside and not freeze your butt?
We've done, I think last year I did throw a bunch of tips, winter warm weather tips in the newsletter. I didn't throw that in there this year, getting, just trying to switch things up a little bit. I'll probably start throwing a couple things out on Twitter. We're pretty big on the Twitter world. Facebook is very active for Winter Field Day as well. And so people really have nice conversations on there. You get some of those people that are not so liking sometimes to they object to our objectives and some other and conversations, you know, but, you know, get some interesting conversations going nonetheless.
You know what those people can do? They can start their spring and fall field days.
That's right.
There you go. Yeah. There's still room for them. Exactly.
Yeah. Cause I need Los Angeles. We need, you know, it's going to be like 60 degrees and really cold here. I need one that's a better time of the year. So it's,
wait a minute, 60 degrees or real cold.
No, 60 and real cold. Oh, 60 degrees is cold. Like, I got a jacket on here in the shack because it's, yeah, you know, 62 degrees here.
I'm in South Carolina. I got the window open to bring some cool air in here. Oh. Well, I got all these computers. They warm the shack up a lot.
Yeah, here in Massachusetts, it's around 30, 35 right now. So
you're balmy right now for you guys.
Exactly. I'm going to throw my shorts on, you know, t-shirt, and go outside.
So you are a 501c3 and you accept donations. What do you need to spend money on?
Again, we do have
luxury vacations for Martin and Mike.
Marvin, but Marvin, sorry. No, that's all right. It's all good. We are completely volunteer. We don't pay anything at all, or get paid anything at all. But we do, you know, try to go to Hamfest, and you know, we pay for our Zoom license for doing presentations. Sometimes we've got, you know, our back end stuff again for the website hosting. We have MailChimp, which we pay dearly for all our mailings and newsletters that we send out. We'll send out some reminders to people. So for example, like, I think going out probably went out yesterday, in fact, said, hey, you know what, you registered last year for Winter Field Day. We haven't seen your register yet this year. Are you going to, you know, get out and play? Just remind you to go to our website, and here's the link to go register. We'll do another one probably right after Winter Field Day, within a couple days afterwards, to everyone who has registered, and we'll parse the data and go, all right, well, I'll use my call site. W0ABT submitted a log, so we won't send an email to him. But W4OPS, who's my brother, used his call sign. I didn't submit a log. Let's send an email to him, and we pull the information from QRZ. And then what we do is send an email and say, hey, looks like you participated in Winter Field Day, but we haven't seen a log from you. You know, you got till March 1st to be able to do that. What we've also done is taken contacts from what we see for logs submitted and goes, oh, look at this. You know, I'll just use my brother again. W4OPS was a contact in the log. He's got 35 contacts in there, but we don't see a log from him. So we'll send him an email saying, hey, we saw that you've made, you know, 35 contacts in Winter Field Day, or at least you were contacted 35 times.
Yeah, How about you submitting a log? You pick that up from looking at other people's logs, right?
We do.
Yeah. So, if I make contacts with a bunch of people, but I don't submit a log and I haven't set up an outdoor station, you'll see my call sign show up in their logs. And then you'll come to me and say, hey, how about being a little more formal about this?
Absolutely. So how about you submit a log too? Because that when we do that cross-checking, so we want to make sure those two contacts touch each other and that they're match up. So we'd like you to submit your log as well. So we'll reach out and do that. So we have that cost with MailChimp. Again, we get the website. We have our website database manager that takes care of all this in the back end. And he makes the tweaks and changes to our website along the way, and things like that. So we do have some cost incurred. I mean, we do have a little bit of, you know, I don't say we have a surplus, but we have some money in our budget right now, which is good. But again, it costs, we got ham radio stickers. We've had ham radio patches or like Winter Field Day patches, Winter Field Day stickers. We did buy an iPad last year for people to sign up for our Winter Field Day newsletter, things like that. So, you know, we've done some equipment and things like that along the way that we need. But,
so I don't know, David, I think these guys need to make like an ARDC grant request for $200,000.
that money's out there, and I would say you guys are a 501c3. Figure out what would help you advertise it, plan it. And I know I've known about the program for a number of years. It was hard to get folks around here like together to like, hey, well, I want to go out and work that weekend and Winterfield Day. And people will complain like I do. Oh, it's going to be cold. You know, in Los Angeles, it's going to be 60 degrees. It's going to be cold that day. And oh, it's a coordinating thing. And oh, we got to get out and find a place to go and all that. And, and you know, and to see there's a lot of people that participate, it would be great to have thousands of people participate. Cause I think this, the structure of the way you guys have it set up and formatted is superior to the other field day. Because it is much more treated like an emergency preparedness event. And you know, the fact that, you know, our summer field day, the regular field day, a lot of the focus is around how many FT8 contacts we made, because it's easy, isn't passing traffic, isn't getting the word out, isn't getting that message out there. It is an exchange where I'm on voice with you, or we're doing CW, or I'm sending, you know, Winlink messages such that I can send a book of information. I think that's important. And again, you know, MCOM's my focus in the hobby, and that's the part that I'm interested in. So it means something to me. And it just means, you know, I would hope that we could get more people interested and involved. And, you know, I know there's some controversy going on with the league right now. We're not going to talk about it in this show because we're going to do one coming up soon and talk about that. But I would love to see people getting out and uncomfortable situations, because that is really, you know, nobody's going to plan that disaster for, you know, hey, it's a lovely Thursday afternoon and it's 78 degrees out there and the sun is shining and you know, we're going to have the disaster then. It's not going to happen then. It's going to happen in the middle of the night when it's cold and dark and the power's out and all those other problems.
Yeah, that's kind of, I mean, you kind of brought it back around, but as I talked about in the very beginning, it may be a disaster in your local area. It may be a disaster you have for, you know, a system, you know, like I said, tornado, maybe a hurricane, you know, came through your neighborhood, your house, your neighborhood, whatever. And so, you know, how are you going to communicate back to your family or friends with those things? You know, we really, again, strive to have that emergency focus. So, you know, there was something else you mentioned I was going to touch base on, but that is what we want to be able to do. And we appreciate the you know, more people getting out there and wanting to do this. And again, just registrations just kind of lets us know where people are at and people can find you. It also just lets people know about ham radio and what's out there for you to go search and visit. If something's in your local area, you want to know what Winter Field Day is, you can go out to our website, find it out. Go to a local place, maybe set up, maybe just talk, communicate, work with somebody, and get interested and get your license. You know, for someone who's watching this, it may not be ham radio licensed already. So let you kind of know what it is, how much fun it is, and what the ability, the capabilities of what ham radio could actually do. So we're, you know, we're also just trying to be educational in many ways as well, for the amateur radio community.
That's a big aspect for us for the regular field day, is it's not only for the amateur radio community, because we try to do it in a park and we try to do it in a public place. And as we have people, you know, come by and, or what are you doing? And that's really an opportunity to engage with the general public. This is what we're doing. And it's an exercise, and we're amateur radio operators. And some of them you pull in and let them participate. Some of them will get on a radio and operate, and some of them won't. And some of them will look and say, oh yeah, my grandfather did that, or my uncle did that. And
exactly, I think that's right.
A great aspect of it. Yeah, absolutely. You know, looking through, you know, the objectives and the rules, I often thought for the regular field day, you know, there are points for Winlink messages, and I love that you guys include that. I often thought, like, when I do that, when we go through that process, I talk to the folks in our group, and we do it through our Aries group, and I get those people to, for the ones that will participate, to give me their out-of-state contact, because I want those Winlink messages, those 10 Winlink messages you can send out for points in the regular field day, to go to someone's out-of-state contact, because that's the way it's going to go in a disaster. And to me, those are valuable points, rather than just, like, you know, sending my dad's license, my son's license, my daughter's are licensed, and they're not home during that period of time because they're away at college, or, you know, one of them's in the Navy or wherever. Send those messages out just saying, hi from field day, right? It'd be great to be able to say, hey, you know, this is we're doing this exercise. It's an emergency preparedness event called Winter Field Day, and I'm sending you this message as my out-of-state contact, because this is how I'm going to get a hold of you in a disaster. And, you know, further emphasizing the event that you're putting on. So an idea for future points.
Do you,
I appreciate it. Yeah.
I didn't notice this as we were looking through the objectives and stuff, but is publicity a big objective? Do you give extra credit for getting publicity out there?
No, we have not done that. Again, we brainstormed a number of different ideas, and we're hoping that, you know, we can steal a few this year, steal a few more next year. You know, inviting a local county commissioner, your city mayor, the news. You know, we've not done that, gone down that road yet, but you know, not saying that we can't make that something in the future that you know, we can certainly include in there and getting more publicity around this. But we're just trying to right now grow Winter Field Day and getting more people involved and getting you know, people interested in getting outdoors and playing, trying to get more people registered in our website, so we kind of see, have an idea. Like last year we had 2,367 logs were submitted with nearly over 296,000 contacts. So that tells me there was probably a lot more people with nearly 300,000 contacts. There was probably a lot more people that could have submitted logs that didn't. And we're just trying to get a better idea of that data, of what is really out there and how many people are participating in Winter Field Day, because we don't know. We just don't know. There's people out there that don't know about us. They go out and participate because they've heard about it, but they don't necessarily we exist as an organization. And you know, that you can register our website, and again, just kind of gives an idea for future publicity for people to go visit. But we're down this year. We're just about, like I said, what did you say, 472, 490, something like that for this year. And we should be closer to almost 800, 900, maybe even 1,000 sites this year. But if we had 2,300 logs were submitted, we should have had close to 2,300 registered people last year. I'm kind of hoping, and not that you have to, but we'd like to know what's there. And again, gives us a reminder to send you out that email that's saying, hey, you know, you submitted a log, you know, or you were involved last year, whatever. And, you know, you submitted a log. We'd like your information, to check those contacts and more people to compare against, and get more people involved.
So I didn't play on the weekend last year. It's typically a week when we've been out skiing and transitioning back to home. So I'm not available to play on that weekend. It just always seems to be the same time. Summer Field Day fills up the bands wall to wall for most of the 24-hour period. So you guys are it looks like maybe 10% of the participation. How would you describe how much of the band you fill up and how easy or hard it is to find stations if you're tuning around looking to make contacts for you?
Last year being our first year really at this, now I've participated in Winter Field Days years before, but you know, I've looked at Summer Field Day numbers a little bit, what I see for sites registered there. I kind of try and look at those. And again, we're not the ARRL Summer Field Day. So we are completely different, but I still know that they have more people registering on their site than we do. And I know the activity level for Summer Field Day is greater than what we are. So again, I'm trying to bump ourselves up to that level. And, you know, I don't know if I can really truly put a, like a 10%, 15%, a 25% number to it. I just don't really know offhand.
I'm pulling the number out of not quite thin air, but I'm trying to remember that, you know, maybe there are about 20 or 30,000 stations on the air for Summer Field Day, and you're showing around 2,000 or so. So
yeah, absolutely. And again, we have about 19,636 different call signs were involved in Winter Field Day last year. And again, we only had 2,367 logs submitted. So if each call sign, now granted, I would say pretty much if every call sign was, there was 19,000 different call signs, we should have had about 19,000 logs roughly. And we had 2,300. So again, and we had 300,000 contacts. So people
are lazy. They don't want to do all that submitting stuff. Getting on the air making contacts is all they want to do.
Well, and that's why we're trying to change it too, because we're seeing this and we're looking at it and going, but people love certificates.
Oh yeah, that's true.
So,
yeah, give us something back for this.
So we're trying to give something back to this. So yeah, we're hoping that will help out a little bit and that we'll see greater increase level, because I still have people reaching out, I don't know, call it within the last 2 weeks, saying, hey, how do I get my 2023 certificate? People love those things. So we're trying to make them a little bit more unique every year, a little different. And, we're hoping we'll continue to grow with that. So,
so David, you've been out doing Winter Field Day for a while. How did you assess the band saturation and activity?
I mean, it's not like the Summer Field Day, but you can find the contacts. The thing is, any given weekend, you turn on the radio and when it's a big contest, a sweepstakes or, a QSO party for a given state, those weekends are busy and there's a lot of traffic. And, a lot of it depends on the antenna you're going to put up and where you're going to be. Winter Field Day is more like a busy contest weekend. It's not like Summer Field Day where you can't find an open spot to save your life. I would love that Winter Field Day gets there. I really try really hard to get my group involved, and it's challenging sometimes to get people out to do anything. Is it like that? No. Is it like a quiet weekend like today would have been? I don't know if there's any context going on. I didn't turn the radio on, but I know a lot of weekends when I come out here, I'll be working on a project and I'll turn the radio on 20 meters, 40 meters, and just have it scan around or at least look at the waterfall to see what's going on. It's definitely Winterfield is a busier weekend in my estimation.
Yeah, so I guess it's going to fall somewhere in between what the big contest that just about fill up the band and maybe a QSO party, a weekend where three or four or five states have the same QSO party going on. You're going to hunt around for stations that are participating.
Well, a couple hundred thousand contacts, it's going to be busy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm kind of interested to see how that looks this year. And again, I think that we will. I think we'll see some increased levels. I mean, I've heard a lot of positive contacts out there talking about this year. So I think we've definitely got more awareness. But I want to kind of touch base real quick. I know we're maybe getting close to the time here, but if you haven't participated before, or even if you have, go out to winterfieldday.com and look at our rules for 2024, and make sure you also update all your software, like N1MM or hammers. N3FJP, which is our favorite, and he keeps up with us most up to date with what we've got. But what we've found also in the years past is there will be 15 different versions of N3FJP out there. Some of them might have 4.07, and Scott is now up to 6.02. They'll have all the versions and everything in between. So go out and update your software to the latest software, whatever you decide to use. And again, we don't limit that. That's up to you. But we prefer that it can get a Cabrillo format or an ADIF format, and you can submit that to us at the end. And, we're January 27th, 28th, about 2 weeks out. Follow us on Twitter. And, we can certainly, we'll be providing some tidbits and hints and stuff over the next 2 weeks as well.
Okay, excellent. I think that pretty well wraps it up. David, you got anything else you want
to? Yeah, the Winter Field Day log is up to 2.8.7. You don't want them to use the Summer Field Day log.
No. Yeah,
that's the one that's the 6X version. I went earlier on because I have the subscription, I've paid for all the things, and so yeah, that one's at 2.8.7, and that to me is the easiest, best of the logging. But we're not getting paid, and there's no guarantee or otherwise. No, I think my 2 cents would be get out. It's always with all of these things, it's, get radioactive, get your radio out, dust it off, use it. Especially because this is an emergency preparedness event. I think we need more of that. There's lots of stuff going on in the world that, would make me want to think that there are more people that are prepared and ready to go in case we need to activate those kinds of resources to be able to communicate. The other podcast I do is really related to, Winlink and Winlink training. And we do a lot of mapping. We do a lot of check-ins and sit rep reports. And we're kind of trying to figure out in the community that we have, we have a list of data of some of the events that we have done, you know, WinLink specific training and testing, where we have, you know, tens of thousands of people's addresses in our database of people that have interacted with us, and to be able to turn that around and use that as a tool to help support the community, you know, however large or small that community is we're talking about in the event of a disaster, it's key, it's important. And we really emphasize getting out and doing that, not just, hey, here in my shack, but outside, away where you don't have all those things. And, you know, my trial for field day out's always the weekend before. I set up in the driveway, and I leave the garage door open, and, you know, and I pile up my stuff, and I'm like, okay, I got everything. Let's make it work. Oh, wait, I forgot this. Oh, wait, I forgot that. Because when you're out in the park or you're on the mountaintop or wherever you are, you can't just make a 259 connector or a pigtail or a, you know, whatever it is. And I've run into those. I hiked with a bunch of scouts up to the top to the tallest mountain that's here in Southern California to make some POTA contacts along with the hiking event. And I forgot 1 6-inch pigtail connector to go into my log periodic antenna. And all I had was the HT, and I had no way to connect it. I still made contacts on the rubber ducky because we were so high up, but I could have made a lot longer, farther contacts, because if I had been more prepared, if I had tested out my gear and set it up ahead of time.
Yeah. I mean, how many times have we gone out and done a POTA contact or a SOTA contact and you forgot, you know, the microphone or the antenna cable or, you know, the antenna or whatever parts. And so it's, you know, making sure that you have those things in a box ready to go, and then you can, you know, kind of do a pre-check, maybe this weekend or next.
Yep.
And, you know, sometime during the week, kind of do a pre-check, like you said, and test your equipment to know that you're good to go for that weekend. It's always a great idea. And every, you know, should be doing that, you know, every, you know, 3, 4, 6 months as well.
What's your setup limit time? The summer field day lets you start setting up on Friday afternoon, and you guys start on Saturday afternoon about the same time, what, 2 p.m. Eastern?
I think it's around 2 p.m. Eastern. That's correct. But I think you can set up on Friday. You've pulled a question out of me that I don't know the 100% answer to be honest, right offhand. But I'm pretty sure you can start setting up on Friday. We're similar to field day, like 24 hours in advance, I think, is what we're, you know, maybe 12 hours in advance.
Yeah, that's what it is. The 1900 UTC on the Friday before. So, okay. Yeah, 24 hours beforehand.
Yep.
Right, so and, but it does similar. Say cumulative setup time shouldn't exceed 12 hours, which is very much aligned with the summer field day.
Yep.
You got 24 hours to do it. Summer field
you
day
have a 24-hour period, but they don't want you to do that whole 24-hour period of setting up.
Yeah, summer field day doesn't have that restriction, I don't think, unless they've added it recently.
They do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think they do. I think that.
Oh, interesting. I paid that much attention, but I know that there have been field day weekends when I'm setting up the station on Friday afternoon, and I don't typically stay out there on Friday night. I'm always bringing more stuff on Saturday morning because I forgot something and, you know, needed to complete the station. All right. Well, Marvin, thank you very much for bringing winter field day to us here on Ham Radio Now, the warm-up act for Ham Radio 2.0, which will be starting in about an hour. For those of you that are watching,
you can follow us over there. You can find us on, you know, I mentioned Twitter quite a bit, but you can find us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and of course, again, our Discord channel. But we'll be over on Ham Radio 2.0, and we'll have a news article coming out on Amateur Radio Newsline this next week's edition. So,
have you been on the Ham Nation? Have you been on the Crash Course?
We have not been over. Well, I mean, we kind of, Ham Nation's kind of hosted by Ham Radio Crash Course.
That's true. That's just same.
So we kind of get that as a 2-in-1 there. So. Yeah. For okay. Sure.
So, but at least we beat Ham Radio 2.0 time-wise. We got you first by an hour.
Absolutely. Well, gentlemen, I appreciate it. Thank you for letting us come on. And just thank you for being part of Ham Winter Field Day this year.
Okay. We'll wrap things up in the broadcasterly fashion.
I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And I'm Gary Pierce, K4AQ, the King of Ham. And, our guest has been Marvin Turner, W0MET. Is that that's a vanity call, I imagine?
It is a vanity call with my initials, exactly.
It's probably just like my vanity call, W0DHG.
I was thinking something about meteorology and winter field day, but that's not it.
So, not quite.
Okay. So thank you once again for being on the show. And we will be back. Be back next week, Jamin? We plan on next week?
Think so. I think I have a topic too.
Okay. One last thing, Marvin. One last thing. You probably never made it to the end of a Ham Radio Now show before, have you?
No.
Okay. We close the show the same way every time, and the guest gets to participate in the close of the show. This will test your radio knowledge, flexibility, et cetera, et cetera. I will say a word. David will say a word. You will have a word that you need to figure out by the time we're done to close the show. Okay.
That's easy.
David, you ready?
Yeah, I am.
Okay, here we go. Over.
And
out.
Nailed it.
Not that hard. Thanks, Marvin.
Thank you, Marvin.
Bye, everybody.
No problem, guys. I appreciate it. Thank you. Have a good night.
Hope to work you on Winterfield Day.
Bye. Absolutely. We'll be out there.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.